Oh, thank you for coming for our next keynote lecture. It's my great pleasure to introduce Paul Bradshaw. We have to say that Paul Bradshaw is one of the authors of books that we are using here and for teaching data journalism. I think one of his very popular books is Data Journalism Haste, in German, the Raubüberfall auf den Datenjournalismus oder Datenjournalismus als Raubüberfall, also in schneller, in Kurzform. So this is a very popular book that we are using, and also the other things that you can find online. He's teaching data journalism and online journalism at the Birmingham University, but there are so many other activities that I stop here, and I just let the floor to you, and you will talk us about a land of milk and honey. So that's something which is closely related to data journalism and not to the other debates that we are interested in very much at the moment. So we just focus on data journalism. Please, Paul Bradshaw, nice to have you here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, the title of A Land of Milk and Honey was given to me, and which I found quite strange that the UK should be seen as, for once, as a nice place, as a good place. And so I thought, well, actually, I guess there's a point to that, and there's also a bit of a myth there. So I thought I would take that idea and run with it. So it come out. The land of milk and honey. I'm going to talk about how we got to this wonderful utopia that we have in the UK, this open data heaven that we live in, obviously. We skip around, happy data journalists. I'm going to talk about the curious creatures that we encountered when we started this journey. And I'm going to finish off with talking about some of the wizards there as well. So I'll start with a bit of history, how we actually got to this position, how we ended up with an open data utopia, if you like. And I think it's quite interesting the forces that have been at play over the last 10 years, 20 years, that have combined to make it, I guess, better to do data journalism in some ways, and we'll come on to the downsides of this. But the positives to begin with. So one of the positives is that the inventor of the World Wide Web happens to be British, which gives you a bit of an advantage when it comes to trying to persuade powerful people to open up data. And Tim Berners-Lee, that person, was very vocal in the late 2000s, particularly in 2009 when he made this TED Talk, about the need to open up data. And in fact, in this TED Talk, he tries to be quite American and kind of get the whole room shouting, chanting raw data now. But he's British and he doesn't quite get away with it. He's still quite awkward. But anyway, so he kind of starts this chant, raw data now. And not long afterwards, he ends up in a meeting with, or in some sort of event with Gordon Brown, who is the Prime Minister of the UK at the time. And Gordon Brown asks Tim Berners-Lee what the government can do to stimulate economic growth. And Tim Berners-Lee starts chanting raw data now, effectively. And says, you know, give us all your data. So Gordon Brown says, okay. And they started releasing data. Very soon, they had launched data.gov.uk. This was about a year after the US launched data.gov, so there was a big US influence here as well. And we started to get all sorts of data being released. So Tim Berners-Lee helps. There were some people in government who understood data as well, Tom Watson in particular. I remember meeting with Tom Watson around this time. But about a year after that, in fact, less than a year, Gordon Brown was no longer Prime Minister, and David Cameron, the Conservative leader, was in charge of a coalition government tasked with the same sort of thing. And the Conservative Party had actually stood with a manifesto calling for more transparency. In fact, I was reading it again, and it was quite weird to find a manifesto calling for a reduction in surveillance and things like that, all sorts of things that the now Conservative government has actually done the opposite of. This was the kind of promise that they made when they came into power. So not only were they going to continue with this open data initiative, but they were going to add new data sets, so more spending data, crime data, local council expenditure. What was notable here was there was a change in emphasis from economic stimulation to transparency. Economic stimulation was still being mentioned, but this was, if you like, a bit more of a political play. And as part of this, they brought in Tom Steinberg. So Tom Steinberg was not a politician. He was in charge of a project called My Society. My Society had been opening up data on voting, on freedom of information requests for about 10 years by this point. And Tom is a major figure, I think, has been another major factor in the open data movement in the UK. And here he was being given a position shaping government policy. So why this shift? Well, we have to go back a little bit. So a few months earlier, the Daily Telegraph had not just broken one story, but story after story after story after story on MPs abusing the expenses system, claiming all sorts of things on expenses that they should not be claiming. This is probably one of the key data journalism stories of the last 20 years in the UK. It gave news organisations an appetite for data journalism. It showed them what was possible. I think this, along with the WikiLeaks stories around the same time. And it was based on a memory stick, which contained lots and lots of PDFs. And those PDFs had been generated because of the Freedom of Information Act, which had been passed some years earlier, about 5 years earlier. Journalist or journalists who had used that Freedom of Information Act to ask for information, that had set in chain a series of events which led to the leak of some of that information. So we've got a kind of a chain of events that you can trace back to the introduction of a Freedom of Information Act as well, a healthy open data culture, and a political environment where David Cameron was able to say, we need to hold MPs to account, we need to be more transparent. And this kind of ties in that there's some other research around this area looking at legislation and the way that shapes journalistic strategies around data. And I think one of the interesting aspects of this is that journalists are supposed to be neutral. But the one area where they are actively adopting a position, they can't avoid really adopting a position, is access to information. As journalists, we have a very strong value around entitlement to information, around transparency, around access, around holding power to account. And it's one of those very interesting tensions in journalism that we can at the same time claim impartiality and that we're apolitical, and yet when it comes to access to information, freedom of information, things like that, we can be quite specifically political. We will lobby for access to information. We will lobby against changes to the Freedom of Information Law, for example. And this was one example of that. And what's been equally interesting, I think, is how little journalists and news organisations have involved themselves in the open data movement, at the same time as they have campaigned for the Freedom of Information and Right to Information laws. So David Cameron wrote a speech when he was still campaigning to be elected around the need to clean up the system. MPs had been painted as particularly corrupt. And he uses this phrase, an army of armchair auditors. So he was hoping that by opening up data, we would have people sat at home, everyday citizens, deciding to scrutinise government spending in particular and hold power to account. And there's something very interesting about this webpage, which I will come back to later. Equally, there's something very interesting about this man, Eric Pickles. Eric Pickles was in charge of a department responsible for local councils, so the regional government, if you like, in the UK. And he was very active in forcing local government to publish their spending information and opening up their political processes as well. This becomes particularly interesting, as I said, a few years down the line. Meanwhile, however, I'll move on to what it was like to live in this land, and the three creatures in particular that I, as a data journalist, have encountered in my journey through this utopia. So in 2015, the BBC set up a data unit, the BBC England data unit, with a specific remit to start looking at data, the increasing amounts of data available to journalists, including open data, and particularly at a regional level. So the BBC already had data journalists based in Broadcasting House in London. They would do kind of the big flashy interactives, national, international stories, things like the Oscars, things like when the global population hit 7 billion. But they didn't really do any data journalism at a more local level. So at this point, I was invited to join this new team, and I still work with that team, in doing these stories. A year later, they set up another data unit, also based in Birmingham, called the Shared Data Unit. And I work with this team too. The Shared Data Unit has a different remit. The main aspect of this remit is that it is reaching outside of the BBC. So politically, again, the BBC is under a lot of pressure, has been under a lot of pressure for a number of years in terms of its role in the media landscape in the UK commercially, how it might interfere with private companies' ability to make profit from the news. And one of the things that the BBC did is set up what is called the Local News Partnership. And this has three aspects to it, one of which is providing video content to local newspapers. Another is employing about 150 reporters that cover courts and councils and are situated inside local newspapers but paid by the BBC, so effectively a subsidy for local newspapers. And the third part was this shared data unit. The shared data unit takes in three secondees from regional newspapers for 3 months at a time, trains them in data journalism while they are pursuing some sort of data-driven investigation. So there's a skills exchange here. Those journalists then go back into the industry, and as a result, quite a few new data teams have been set up in regional newspaper groups, staffed by these people who learnt their data journalism skills in the unit. The other aspect is that the stories generated by this team are sent to a network of about 900 partners across the UK. So these are local newspapers, local news websites, even broadcasters, radio stations, TV channels, about a week ahead of an embargo, so that each of those publications has an opportunity to take that story and add to it, do some additional reporting to provide a local angle. So you can see, for example, someone might do an investigation into medical errors or NHS blunders, and you can see that we've got the Lancashire Post there, who've been given this data and a little briefing pack ahead of time. They'll have done some extra interviews, they'll have looked at what the data is like in their patch, in their area, and they've done their story. The Gazette, which I think is in Newcastle, will have done the same sort of thing, but in the northeast of England. And often this generates about 80 stories, between 50 and 80 stories probably, each time an investigation is done. So there's a really interesting dynamic where there's a data journalism skill set and culture being sent back into that regional press, and those stories which are a kind of a proof of concept of what data journalism can do. And obviously, I think these are all front page stories. So that was set up in 2016, again, often working with open data. So the creatures that we've encountered along the way, well, the first one is lots of data, what I would call the scarecrow problem, okay? You're going to see a theme developing here. You're going to soon get tired of it, probably. For example, a year after David Cameron took up his position as Prime Minister, as promised, the police forces in the UK started publishing open data on all the crimes that were reported and the outcomes, and also stop and search, where people are stopped and searched because they are suspected to have a weapon or drugs or something else. The website is data.police.uk, and it's tremendously useful for a journalist. So a couple of years ago, as police cuts were starting to hit, we'd already done stories about the number of police that had been lost, which was also based on open data. We wanted to look at how many crimes were going unsolved because basically the police didn't have enough officers to investigate. The problem was, if you go to that website and download all the data on crime, you end up with over 2,400 files, each one in its own folder, each folder in another folder. So this is 40 police forces, 12 months, and about 5 years. That's quite tricky to work with. It might be open, but it's not easy. When you add up all those crimes, you end up with about 37 million rows as well. So as a single file, this is quite big. So this is kind of the natural reaction, I think, to this news. But I would say a key process here in dealing with this sort of problem is computational thinking. The more I've kind of worked in the data unit, the more I've realized that it's not just the technical skills that are important in data journalism. Yes, you might be able to code in Python or use pivot tables or whatever it is, but actually there's a process of thinking that really makes the difference between two journalists with exactly the same skill set. And it's this logical ability to break down a problem, to abstract it, to see patterns, and to create a recipe, an algorithm that allows you to solve those problems in turn. And Jeanette Wing, who is one of the kind of, I guess, main proponents of computational thinking, writing in 2004, has a really nice paragraph about this, which taps into some of the things that Jonathan mentioned earlier on about the difference between, if you like, scientific research and journalism. So she does talk about reformulating a seemingly difficult problem into one we know how to solve through these processes, abstraction, pattern recognition, and so on. But she also talks about whether an approximate solution is good enough. And often in journalism, that's the case. You know, it doesn't have to be perfect. The fact that ProPublica was dealing with margins of error didn't mean it wasn't good enough. It was a step further. And I think that's the test that we often have as data journalists is, are we moving the conversation forward? Are we adding something new? And I'll talk a bit more about this later. But an approximate solution often is enough to start it, whether it's a debate about the quality of data or the quantity of data and so on. And she also talks about whether false positives or false negatives are allowed. This is another really significant difference between scientific or academic research and journalism, which actually I would say is kind of more in favor of journalism than the other. In science, we can deal with false positives because there's not necessarily a real world impact to that. In journalism, if we wrongly identify an individual or correctly identify the wrong individual, we'll get sued. So if you like, journalism is less tolerant of false positives and false negatives than science might be. We can't say we're 95% certain that this politician is corrupt, to use Jonathan's analogy earlier, and publish false findings, because it's not going to stand up in a court of law. So this comes into play in particular with mapping. If we're going to map particular points, one of the journalistic solutions to this is we will use a density map. So we won't identify specific points. We'll say, broadly speaking, this area is hot and this is cold when it comes to particular incidents. But we know that because there's some false information here, we're not going to be too specific. We're just looking at the overall pattern. So this was my, putting that into practice, this was my solution to the first problem. How do I get these 2,400 CSVs into one document that I can interview, that I can ask questions of? And it's a piece of script, it's a command line script, and there's actually only five lines of working code. The rest is these echo lines are just me kind of explaining what's happening. So it looks, we've downloaded all these files, they're all in different folders, it looks for all the files that end in street.csv, and that's pattern recognition. So that's me spotting a pattern in the data. All these files end in street. They've got the name of the force, which changes each time. They've got the year and the month, but it always ends in street. And I first of all obviously make sure that I've got no other CSV files on my computer with street.csv in them. But that's the pattern recognition at work. It's then going to make a new directory to put them in. It's going to move them all into that. Then I'm going to shift into that directory, and then I'm going to combine all of the files into one, which I'm calling crimescombined.csv. So only, like I said, five lines of code, and that's combined my 2,400 files into one. But it's very big. In fact, when I used command line to ask how many lines are there in this file, it took an hour to give me the answer. Very simple question. I knew that if I was going to ask anything more complex than that, I didn't want to be waiting around for the answer. So the next stage of a problem, breaking down that problem into different parts, was how do I handle a 37 million raw data set and ask it questions? So I turned to Google BigQuery, which is a tool for handling big data. You can upload big data sets. You get about $250 credit, so you can run lots of queries to begin with before having to actually spend any money. And when I asked the same question on there, I got an answer within a second. So that's a big improvement on an hour. So we queried that data using BigQuery. And that was kind of the scarecrow problem around dealing with lots of data, lots of different files, and some of the different techniques for doing so. This is the story that we ended up with. An increase in the number of crimes that were not being solved, and particular crimes, you were very unlikely to get any sort of police action, and different forces being worse than others. Same sort of problem occurs again and again and again. This is one recently. We wanted to look at the quality of rivers. There's a target that they're supposed to be hitting in a few years' time that we kind of hinged the story on. But again, we've got a number of different river basin districts, and each one has its own files. So we're in this position again. We've got to somehow bring them together. But again, kind of breaking it down, going through, solving each problem in turn. This is the story that we ended up with. More examples. In the UK, the NHS publishes almost live data, actually. So this is particularly valuable journalistically. And one of the problems with open data is it's often not up to date, if you like. It might be even the crime data is about 2 months behind. But this is quite rare, in that it is data which is about a day or so up to date. So it's yesterday or 2 days ago. So you can kind of talk about now, which is quite rare in data journalism. It's so valuable that the BBC team in London invested a lot of resources in creating a weekly A&E tracker. And this is basically a scraper that goes and grabs all those files, combines them into one, again, and asks certain questions so that people can find out about how their local hospital is performing, particularly against government targets of the number of people that should be seen within 4 hours, for example, and so on. And this has been expanded over a number of years. This has run for a number of years and was only stopped about a couple of months ago, and that was because the government decided to abandon the targets. It had stopped hitting them for so long, they said, let's not bother pretending anymore that we're even trying to hit these targets. What's really interesting about this is the data is open, but it's not accessible. What the A&E tracker have done, or has done, is turn this open data into something that people can actually interrogate, can interact with, can search, can explore. And this is a particularly interesting tension in journalism between, you know, we know about the definition of open data. I'm not going to bore you with that whole thing, which you've probably seen a million times. You know, we know about it being machine readable. We know about it being legally reusable. But that doesn't mean that an army of armchair auditors is going to get to grips with it. And that kind of journalistic activism of making it open, bringing it to an audience, not just as a story, but as a tool, is something that I don't think we've seen nearly enough of in the UK. And if anything, I think we've seen a decline in that sort of activity. Around 2010, The Guardian launched its data blog. A lot of their stories were simply about opening up data. As data journalism got more sophisticated, as the personnel changed, they stopped updating the actual data blog. And it became more about stories. In fact, Guardian Australia is one of the main outlets that actually now publishes on the Guardian data blog. So one thing I'm very keen on in the data unit is, one of the first things I did was set up a GitHub account, and every story that we publish, I put on the what data sets we've used, but I also include who we've interviewed and what types of data visualization we've used. So there's something that can be scraped essentially and used to analyze our output and see what sorts of subjects are we tackling, what sorts of sources are we using, and so on. And sometimes people will use that data and do additional data journalism with it. The other thing that this highlights, this large amount of data, is just how much as journalists we still rely on a hypothesis-driven approach to these large data sets. We still approach these data sets with a question. So 37 million rows. I wasn't messing around kind of just looking for strange kind of patterns. We had a particular story in mind. We had a hunch about unsolved crime. That was what was we were kind of hearing rumors about. What Parisi identified in her research into, I think it was a Chicago newsroom a few years ago, was this the potential for a data-driven path, which is more about, if you like, serendipity, about challenging our news judgments as journalists and presenting us with possible story leads that we might not be looking for in this data. Now, I am at the moment working on a machine learning project with Quartz, which is trying to do that data-driven method. And I think AI has some interesting possibilities and potential impacts to have in data journalism around exposing us as journalists to dimensions of data that we might not have otherwise tried to look at. So that might be a collection of documents, and let's look at certain phrases that seem to be associated with each other. Or it might be unusual fluctuations in data sets over time or whatever. But that's a whole other talk. Moving on. Two, it's a big number. This is the second creature that we encountered on our journey. Stories that have a big number in them, what I would call the Tin Man problem. And I call it the Tin Man problem because if you're taking a set of data like this is the spending data that I mentioned earlier, local councils, every local council has to publish this. You might generate a story about just how much money is being spent on one thing or another. And in fact, I've used this data for years to look at B&B accommodation for people who are homeless. So legally, councils are not supposed to put people in B&B accommodation for longer than 6 weeks if it's a family. But that gets routinely broken. Families are left in B&B accommodation, and the B&Bs make a lot of money out of this. But that's just a big number. Jane Haynes, who wrote this story, she was a student of mine at Birmingham City University, and so we'd done this with her. But what she did was she went to the bed and breakfast, she spoke to the people who were living there, and she turned this from just a big number into a story that actually mattered, that told us why that number matters. So this is the main story, that's just a side note. So, you know, the data might be open, but we still need to add a heart to that. And this is something that my colleagues at the BBC, Dan Wainwright and Rob England, and Peter Sherlock in the Shared Data Unit, and Alex Homer, routinely do. If they can find some sort of story that tells us why this matters, then they will do. So the rivers pollution story, you can see in the top right there, we've got a case study in there about someone who did a swimming challenge in a river and was taken to hospital after swallowing sewage. This is about unduly lenient sentencing and someone whose mother was knocked over by someone dangerous driving, and so on. The third creature is scary documents. So you're all familiar with the horror of PDFs as some sort of form of open data. This is a story we did quite early on in the life of the data unit. Just how big was the scale of cuts to libraries in the UK? Lots of libraries are closing. There's a big reliance on volunteers rather than paid staff. And there's data on library opening times and the numbers of books being taken out and staff in these PDFs, one for each library authority, 150 of them, for each year. So again, we've got about 450 documents here. I wrote a scraper to go through them. But luckily, we also used the Freedom of Information Act and sent out FOI requests to each authority. And this was lucky because we'd been working on this for months, and then there was a parliamentary question asking what we were trying to find out. And there was a moment when we kind of started panicking and thinking all of our month's work is going to be completely scooped by someone answering this question in Parliament. Because we'd done our work, we realised that the answer was based on those PDFs. The Freedom of Information request that we had done had given us more information and more up-to-date information. So the government knew less than we did about how many libraries had closed. It didn't know how many staff had gone. And conveniently, the numbers were nice and round. It was 1 in 4 staff had gone in the space of 5 years, 1 in 10 libraries had closed. And it was a story that we ran right across the BBC when it eventually broke. So this is about courage and I guess hard work to some extent. We often get, when we get to near the end of a story, we seek a right of reply from the organisation involved, and every so often they'll come back saying, you're wrong, your data's wrong. Not your data's wrong, but your analysis is wrong. And for a moment, we'll panic again and we'll kind of think, oh, have we got this wrong? And I think a journalist who is starting out in journalism and data journalism can possibly be intimidated by this, particularly if you're dealing with in-house statisticians, things like that. So with the unsolved crime story, you know, we had one police force come back quite strongly saying, you know, we're going to insist on a correction, and you're completely wrong. What we do every time is go back and say, well, how exactly? Can you show us how you've arrived at some different figures, and we'll, you know, compare methodologies. And a lot of the time, it's just they prefer a different methodology which gives them a different answer. And it's not necessarily a relevant one, it's just the one that looks best for them. So you need that kind of courage to stand up to those responses and say, well, show me. You know, I'm open to suggestions, but we're all grown-ups here. You show me how you've arrived at your figures, and I'll show you what we've done. And it might be that they want to use a different data set, or they want to use a different definition or classification. This also happens after publishing. This was a story we published based on crowdsourced open data on electric charging points. This was the response from one person on Twitter who accused us of pure clickbait. Now, this person runs a service that provides data on charging points. But he wouldn't give it to us. So he was telling us that the story was anti-electric cars, but he wouldn't actually give us the data that he seemed to think was the right data. It was just, you know, you're wrong, it's rubbish, trust me. And I won't bore you with the arguments that went back and forth about this, but this was part of a conversation that I had with him on Twitter. So I said I wouldn't bore you with the definition of open data, but unfortunately it slipped in there one way or another. You know, you can't have your cake and eat it, even in Brexit land. So those are the three creatures that we encountered along the way, the scarecrow of large data sets, the lion of kind of scary situations, and the tin man of big numbers without context. Now we come to the wizard. I mentioned Eric Pickles earlier. Eric Pickles might have been very keen for local councils to publish their spending and to be transparent, but he wouldn't necessarily obey the same sorts of transparency rules himself. So he was not declaring meetings with lobbyists. I said about this speech by David Cameron earlier. This speech is only available online because my society have archived it after the Conservative Party deleted its entire archive, its entire history of speeches in 2013. Who runs my society? Tom Steinberg, who was invited by David Cameron to be in that group of advisors way back in 2010. So we can't trust, the authorities, the people publishing open data, to either get it right or publish the right data or to continue doing so. Even very early on in the life of data.gov, there was an analysis that was done comparing the data that was being published with the data that people actually used, and it was very different. In the US, data.gov was increasingly criticized and has been increasingly criticized for the data that it chooses to publish and not to publish. Ellen Miller from the Sunlight Foundation makes a great speech again way back in 2010 about the fact that, for example, you can get the numbers of wild horses on data.gov but not data on pollution incidents involving companies. So some of my favourite stories as a data journalist, the ones that I'm happiest with myself, are the ones that don't rely on someone giving me that data openly. This was a story I wrote about discrimination in the housing market. I was way back in the dark 1980s, landlords used to put a sign up saying, no blacks, no Irish, no DSS. Now, the blacks and the Irish, you can understand, as in literally understand, not sympathise with, obviously. But no DSS referred to the Department for Social Security, and it basically meant we won't let anyone live in this house who is claiming benefits. Now, the DSS stopped existing many years ago. It's now the Department for Work and Pensions. But even now, 20, 30 years on, 40 years on, you were getting adverts saying no DSS as a shorthand for we don't accept people on benefits. And I wanted to see how big was the scale of this. So I scraped some websites where you can find housing. And I found not only was it massively prevalent, like in the 90s of percentages, but because it also, I was also looking at how many people said no pets, pets were more welcome than people on benefits, basically. So it was a nice kind of context to that story. And this isn't open data. Likewise, Niamh McIntyre at The Guardian did a brilliant piece of data journalism earlier this year on the numbers of schools using crowdfunding websites and Amazon to raise money for their schools. So they were to get donations because they're so short of money. So they were setting up shops on Amazon where you could buy pencils for the school. So not for you, but those pencils would go to the school. Or you could buy books or whatever it was. Again, based on scraping. There's also the stories about a lack of transparency or lack of enforcement of rules. So we did a story on, we picked a sample of 100 schools and we manually checked whether they were publishing required documents on their websites about all the interests that governors had in terms of what companies they were involved in, what potential conflicts of interest there were. And we found that 1 in 5 were not publishing this data at all, but no one was enforcing it. Likewise, companies in the UK now have to submit information on their gender pay gap, on how much women are paid compared to men, how many bonuses women get compared to men, and so on. Very early on, we started to question this and highlighted a number of companies who had a very suspicious 50% men and women, 50% composition everywhere, and 0% gender gap. They had a statistically highly improbable mix of data. And we went to the government body that was responsible for enforcing this, and they seemed very concerned. And then 2 months later, The Telegraph did the same story, and they seemed very concerned. But still, this is shit data, basically. There's companies reporting nonsense, and no one really enforcing it. The Bureau of Investigative Journalism manually counted homeless deaths because no one was counting it. Now the ONS counts it. Speaking of homelessness, there are also stories which I think the data unit could do better with. So data is released on homelessness, but we run the risk, and this is where I'll bring in a passage from some research on open data and journalism. We run the risk of kind of reinforcing the authority of those in power rather than challenging it. Now, in this story, there was a reality check kind of box which kind of explained some of the issues with this data. And the issues with homelessness data is that there are two different ways of counting how many people are homeless in different parts of the UK. You can either do a spot check, which is that you go out on a particular night and someone counts how many people they see, or you measure how many people are accessing particular services in your area. And the national figures have a mix of these two figures, and different years, the same place might use a different methodology. So it's really quite not very reliable. The Guardian did a much better job on this. The Guardian found that, yes, it appeared to have dropped, but actually where it had dropped was where councils had changed their measurement system. And there was a very strong suggestion that councils were hiding the problem by using spot checks And also doing it on like a snowy night when there are likely to see much fewer people sleeping on the streets. So we come home at the end of all of this, and we come home to journalistic key principles. And Kovach and Rosenstiel, their 10 principles of journalism generally, are well worth reading. I tried to kind of use those as a basis for 10 principles of data journalism. And this one in particular, I think, is relevant when it comes to open data, which is that open data has the potential to undermine our independence as journalists. It has the potential to make us more inclined to report certain types of stories rather than others, to cover certain subjects rather than others, to make editorial choices that we wouldn't necessarily make. The most obvious dimension of this is an institutional skew towards the public sector. So open data is local councils, national government, national statistical organisations. It's not private companies. So straight away, we're scrutinising one part of society and not another. And as certain services are delivered more and more by the private sector, that becomes hard to hold that to account. So I think we need to work extra hard to retain that impartiality from our sources and look for stories in the private sector, for example, but also in topics that might not have as much open data as others. This is the wizard part of the journey, in that this is about misdirection. You could argue that the requirement on local councils to publish their spending data was a classic piece of political misdirection to try and get journalists to blame local authorities, local government, for problems rather than national government. So it's always kind of worth questioning, why are we being given this information at all? Maps are particularly vulnerable to this, I think, and Theo Kindenis has done some really good work on crime mapping and crime data in the criminology field, and he makes a really strong point about mapping crime, which is probably one of the most common pieces of data journalism, certainly one of the earliest pieces of data journalism with Adrian Holovaty and Chicago Crime. The problem with crime mapping is it doesn't show non-geographical crime. So things like cybercrime, financial crime, environmental crime do not appear on maps necessarily. They don't have a single place, a single point where they are committed. And of course, there's a social dimension to this visibility as well. So if we're mapping crime, should we be thinking about the biases that builds into our reporting? So to wrap up then, and to sum up, first of all, I would argue that as data journalists, it's important to, if you like, come home to those core principles of journalism, in particular the need for independence from our sources and impartiality. Scraping, I'm a big fan of scraping, partly because it allows me to do that. It allows me to gather my data regardless of FOI and a body being subject to legal means of requesting data. Secondly, computational thinking gives us a really useful conceptual approach to solving data journalism problems. Thirdly, we must always remember the heart in the stories that we're telling, the why this is important, why this matters, why someone should care about these numbers. And finally, as journalists, we should always have the courage to check the information that we have, to seek information independently of the open data that we're getting. We should have the courage to not merely believe what someone is telling us if they're telling us their data is wrong or indeed right, and the courage to question ourselves and to be prepared to admit and to see that we are right, to double check. Those are the 4 points I want to leave you with, and that leaves us with about 10 minutes for questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. 10 minutes for questions. So then I start with one question that I have. there's sometimes debate concerning open data, if open data should really mean open data for everybody. For example, Rosie van Dijk, who was here yesterday, said a couple of years ago, so at the moment, if everything is open data, there are above all maybe 4 or 5 companies who can really make use of it. This is Google, Facebook, and so on. So what do you think? Should we still continue to have a regulation as we have it, for example, in Germany, to make a difference if, for example, a journalist or a scientist wants to have data, public data, between other people like companies or just citizens? So what do you think about this problem?
There's every so often there'll be a kind of a debate surfaces around freedom of information and the same sorts of things around, well, it's being used by companies to get commercial data. And, I think you have to remember that the basis for freedom of information access to data, and I would say in the case of most open data, is that we as taxpayers have paid for the collection of this information. Even before you get into the arguments about transparency. So companies pay tax as well, would be my argument. I think companies have a right to access the information that they have paid through their taxes to be collected. So yes, it might be commercially valuable. As I said, the whole drive initially in the UK for opening up data was about economic value, and there was big pressure for postcodes to be opened up. So I think it's very difficult to start differentiating on that basis. I think as soon as you start trying to say who is a journalist and who is not, you get into some very tricky territory. I think there's a lot of value in, and some of the most interesting data journalism is done by people who are not subject to the pressures and commercial and editorial pressures of newsroom and journalism. So, you know, people ask some really good questions when they're not journalists. I'd broadly say I can't see, there's an argument both ways, but I can't see a strong argument for limiting access and introducing some sort of it kind of smacks of a bit of jealousy in terms of, well, those companies are really successful and we don't want them to be more successful.
But do you see also some special dangers of misuse where you would even agree to limit the accessibility to open data?
Yeah, I think there's a difference between the idea of a general limitation on all open data and having, you know, specific data sets which are either not open or can only be used for certain purposes. I think it's tricky when you get into anything that's personally identifiable. And I think there's a really interesting, a very rich area for discussion in data journalism about the sliding scale between, to give a concrete example, in the US, data about people's court appearances is public, but making that proactively kind of findable and searchable is a different degree of openness. And that has opened up all sorts of ethical issues around, well, should we be, there's a difference in accessibility. It's that difference between open data and accessible data. And perhaps the debate is more about accessibility than about openness. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you for your talk. And what I want to know, what do you see any space for improvement in the UK open data regulation, except for scary document formats?
Yes, always. Yeah. As I said, it was quite weird to be asked to talk about an open data utopia, because living in the UK, we're constantly complaining about not having access to this information, or this information being in a particular format or whatever. So I think certainly the liveness of information is one area that could be massively improved. And you know, as I said, the types of information that are chosen. So I'm trying to think of some off the top of my head. Sentencing data is not particularly open in terms of, so if I wanted to know which judge, whether certain judges were more lenient or more harsh than others, that's not really something I can get through open data in the UK, or even probably the FOI Act. And there'll be lots of, it kind of depends on particular stories that you're trying to do, but I guess the number one would be, I think any company that provides, that is getting public money, should have to publish data about what it's doing in the same way that a public body has to. And I would add to that company accounts as well, because company accounts are buried in PDFs, and we've done quite a lot of work with that. If that was open data in some way, that would massively improve our ability to hold companies to account.
Okay. So thank you very much for this interesting insight in a land of milk and honey.
Thank you.
And we continue now with 3 sessions, one in this room and the other one in the other one. So thank you much for coming, and good luck for your further work. Thank you, Paul Burchett.